Kia ora tātou, tēnā tātou, kua hui hui mai nei, ko tāu mai ki tēnei kaupapa, hei whakawhitiwhiti, whakaaro waiata, hoki kata kata hoki, so tēnei te mihi ki a koutou, ko tāu mai nei. Me mihi tuatahi ki te haukāinga o te whangani ātara, te ati awa taranaki whānau, whānau, tēnei te mihi ki a koutou, hei kāhutia ki a mātou, mai ngā haue whā, no reire, tēnei te mihi, tēnei te mihi. Ki a koe, Tānia, tēnei te mihi ki a koe, hei tūwhera te kōrero nei, mō te ahi ahi, nō reiri, tēnei te mihi ki a koe, my Featherston neighbour, kia ora. And kia hapori tira, tino reka, te waiata nei, hei whakatūhono tātou ia tātou, koina te mahi o ngā pūoro, te reo o te wāo tāne, nō reiri, tēnei te mihi ki a koutou, kua waiata mai. Kia ora everybody, great to see you all here, some friends in whānau, reconnecting, feels like ages since we've been able to do that. Oh, kia ora, wow, fine. I'll catch up later. But yeah, this feels like a novelty, eh? Over the last couple of years, we've been a bit lonely, a bit muki-muki to connect face-to-face. Tinana a tinana, you know, be able to, oh, a real person. So, yeah, just a real privilege to be invited here to Te Puna a Māttauranga. Hei whakawhiti kōrero e pāna Matariki. So, ai, ko wai au ko Warren Maxwell ahau, I thought I'd just tell a little bit of who I am and where I've sort of my background, just to contextualise a little bit. I'll try not to ramble on. You know, e hara te kumara e kōrero ki tōna reka, e don't you now. So, yeah, ko Warren Maxwell ahau. My hapu, my iwi, Ngāti Whare, Ngāi Te Riu, Ngāti Rakaipaaka and Ngāi Tūkairangi. So I'm on that journey, you know, I was of that era where mum didn't teach us te reo, didn't really, you know, pass on who we are, where we're from. It was that generation, you know, where our mums and dads or grandfathers, grandmothers were smacked for speaking te reo. And yeah, so I'm on the journey of reconnection. Reconnecting with my taha Māori. I'm very proud of all of the whakapapa I have here. My mum says we're a fruit salad. You know, got a bit of Scandinavian and a bit of English and a bit of Scottish and a bit of Māori and a bit of, even found out a little bit of German, did a DNA test. I said, kia ora, cousin. but I love that, you know, celebrating all of the threads that make up who we are. So, yeah, so I've got tūhoi tanga in there and kahanunu tanga as well. And, oh, kia ora, Ray, kia ora, whana. I wanted to talk a little bit about, I guess where I came from. So I grew up in Whangarei, but my mum's from Ruatahuna. Anyone know where Ruatahuna is? Yeah, right in the middle of Te Uruwera, right in the bush. Now, I think I can use the pointer here, there, but apparently people on Zoom can't really see the laser thing. So right in the middle of Te Uruwera, mum grew up with Nani Taya, Kutia, not far down the road from Tata Huata Marae. And kanu I te mihi ki te haukainga, kei reira, I rua tāhuna. And my dad grew up in the Hokianga, way up there. So how they got together, you ask? Wow, that's a he kōrero anō, that one, that's another story. But it was love, it was aroha. Dad was working in Rotorua and mum was working at the restaurant there as a waitress and, you know, eyes met and sparks flew and woo-wee, all that stuff. So because Dad was from Hokianga, we grew up in Whangarei. I grew up away from my tūhoi tana, my tūhoi side, although we had lots of cousins and aunties come up and visit us, you know, it wasn't really spoken about a lot where we come from. So yeah, grew up in Whangarei. Did my trade as a builder, because music wasn't really a real job back in the 80s, unless you're going to join the symphony orchestra or something. So it was suggested and highly encouraged that I take up a trade. And it was a good trade. I was a terrible builder, didn't you? But I'm really thankful that I've got those skills now, you know. Hey, builders are expensive these days. So it's nice being able to whip up a wonky kind of deck or something a bit creative, shall we say. 1989, I moved to Wellington. I had a few friends down in Wellington who were studying at the Polytech down here, and they were just raving about Wellington, eh? I said, oh, it's an awesome city, you know, bright lights. I remember driving down Noronga Gorge. I think we came down, we must have got into town about 5 o'clock in the evening, and the sun was just going down, and it's just that classic scene, eh? You come down around that bend, and there's all these beautiful lights of the big city, you know, came from Whangarei, big city lights, and it's like, wow. So that was me, fell in love instantly with Wellington, and yeah, haven't really, it's my second home really. Studied jazz back then, it was the Polytech, Wellington Polytech, and then towards the end of the millennium, I finished my degree in jazz. Yeah, I'll just talk a little bit about that period. Oh, can you spot me? When I talk about music as being, you know, deeply embedded in myself and my family, mum and dad were very encouraging of our musical upbringing. So we didn't have a TV, really. We used to rent a TV in the winter for a few months, but then it went back to the rental shop and music was our entertainment. So that's me in the middle there. Haven't changed much, eh? But I started learning saxophone when I was 11 years old, and by the time I got to high school, apparently they thought I was good enough to be first lead alto saxophonist in the Whangarei Boys and Girls big band. I have really, really fond, wonderful memories of that band, you know, a bunch of young rangatahi swinging like Glenn Miller, you know, it was like, wow, String of Pearls, In the Mood, all of those old wartime big band dance songs, you know, and it's the luxury of hindsight that I look back and go, far out, that band could swing. That band was, and I've got to say it's testament to our band leader, Jim Thorne, I mati e ia, so ka mihi ki a ia. But he was just he was one of those really, really supportive music teachers, you know. He'd pick you up in the morning to take you to school if it's raining, you know, he'd ring up and say, oh, do you need a lift? He used to play me like Grover Washington and Marcus Miller and Steve Gadd and all of those kind of really hot LA session musicians, you know. That was the kind of music I was listening to in my teenage years. And I think that fed into, you know, that whole band. So the groove of that band is still with me. And I think it's the thing about music, hey, and just when you were singing before, it has this ability to connect people, you know, we're singing together, something intangible. It's an ancient practice. So when you're getting a group of young rangatahi playing in a big band like this, and there's the discipline of you know, playing in a groove within a thousandth of a second kind of thing, like really nailing the groove, you know, that's a really good skill to have. Yeah. So yeah, fond memories of Whangarei Boys and Girls High. So I moved to Wellington, studied jazz. When I finished my undergrad, that was about 93, I reckon, I got a call from Southside of Bombay, and their saxophonist was leaving the band, and they called me and said, hey, do you want to join? I was like, whoa. And I got to say that Southside of Bombay, my time with them, I was probably with them for about 3 or 4 years. That was the first time that I'd really experienced whanaungatanga through a Māori lens, you know. I'd grown up quite Pākehā, which is really amazing, awesome, and I'd never really experienced whanaungatanga. I hadn't gone to the marae much, you know, hadn't been in kapahaka. And so when I started touring with Southside, they were all about that, all about te ao Māori, all about whanaungatanga and connection, aroha. And it was a really influential time for me. And I think when I formed Trinity Roots a few years later, the influence of Southside actually, you know, informed how Trinity Roots wanted to be. At that time, it was Ricky Gooch and Rio Himapua and myself in the band. And we were all similar, Rio had had quite a strong upbringing in te ao Māori, living, coming from Taumarunui. But none of us had te reo, you know, none of us had karakia or that kind of knowledge. So we signed up with the Wellington Polytechnic to study te reo for a year. Rio did 2 years. And that was one of the best things I've ever done, I reckon. Just that 1 year of full immersion study, it just flipped my mindset and opened up who I am, you know. And that was it. So for 20-odd years. But, you know, whakapapa, it's a lifetime thing, eh? It's not a three-year diploma or something. It's a lifetime thing. So I feel like that time that we went to study, that was the springboard. That was the spark. I was like, wow, this is stunning. And I still remember karakia and waiata from that time, and I want to mihi to my kaiako from that time as well. A couple have passed on. Yeah, but ka nui te mihi kia rātou kua whakaako ki hau. And at the same time, or just not long after Trinity formed in 1998, I joined this bunch of misfits, Fat Freddy's Drop. There's a few people out here who reckon I will remember this amazing halcyon decade of just incredible music that was going on. I want to say the mid-90s through the mid-2000s. 95, I don't know, we were just getting a fusion of incredible music. You know, DJ Moo would be playing down at Matterhorn, and I'd turn up with my saxophone, Dallas would turn up, you know, get on the mic, and you just have an amazing jam. And then people started taking notice and going, hey, this is really cool, this is different, you know. Just that no fear of fusing different styles of music together, getting jazz musicians coming together with roots, DJs, you know. So, yeah, that's where that band came out of, really, Fat Freddy's Drop, and, of course, has gone on to do some pretty incredible things and still is to this day, yeah. I left Freddy's, 2005, that's when we had our first bubba. So it was that really difficult choice of, okay, I want to tour over to Europe, to Germany and Spain, or do I stay home and be a dad? And so I chose the latter. But I've got to say, I get green with envy when I see some of the festivals that they play at. It's like, oh. But yeah, they're amazing whānau. So yeah, Southside Bombay, Trinity Roots, Fat Freddy's Drop, and of course Little Bushman is another group that I'm still engaged with, which is a bit more psychedelic blues, experimental music. So in 2006, a year after we had our first bubba, Lily Raukura, we thought, we were renting in Lyle Bay, and we thought, geez, we better grow up and buy a whare. Couldn't afford a whare in Wellington on a musician's wage, so we looked around, we were thinking Kapiti Coast or out towards the Wairarapa. And I was very keen to move over to the Wairarapa, because I thought I could just feel Kapiti growing, you know, developing, like almost becoming like Gold Coast in Queensland or something, because everyone wants to live by the sea, although I'm not sure anymore with climate change. So Wairarapa came calling. We went out there and we just found our dream home. You know, we just found a two-acre section with two relocated houses on it, old 1950s weatherboard houses, no trees. But yeah, ka karanga mai te whare and ka karanga mai Wairarapa, and we've been there for 16 years since. Absolutely love it. Much like Tanya, eh? It's got that village mentality I was talking before, eh? It's just, you know, there's a beautiful vibe out there. I remember the first day we went for a walk on a Saturday morning, and this big fellow was walking down the road, you know. I was like, oh, here we go. And he got closer and he put his hand out and he's like, oh, g'day, mate. And I was like, oh, g'day. Yeah, nice day. He's like, yeah, great day for drinking puss. And it's like 8 o'clock on a Saturday morning. I was like, oh, yeah. I was like, oh, I'm home. Not so much for that kind of thing, but I think just the openness, the fact that he reached out his hand and looked you in the eye and was like, wow, this is awesome. Yeah, so it's got that beautiful country feel about it, 1 hour from Wellington. Whew, love it. Yeah. So I've got these images up here. Beautiful kohunui marae out towards Pirinoa and Papawai marae over in Greytown. And this is sort of heading into our Matariki kōrero. So I'm not from the Wairarapa, you know, e hara I te mana whenua, kei reira. So I'm what's known as taurahere, you know, someone who comes from a different kinship, a different tribe, a different hapu. But I'm living in a place where I'm connecting and supporting, and I want to connect with mana whenua. Mana whenua over in the Wairarapa are rangitāne and kahanunu. And we also have a good connection with over there with Te Atiawa, Taranaki whānui. And the Tararua Range and the Remutaka hills are known as a Tatau Paunamu. And that is, in Māori terms, is a doorway, a greenstone doorway. And the metaphor of that is that there will always be peace between Wairarapa iwi and Te Atiawa iwi. And that Tatau Paunamu was formed back in the 1830s, I think, between Te Whare Pauri and Nuku Pewapewa. So yeah, when you think of those hills, the Remutaka and the Tararuas, as a sign of peace between iwi on that side and iwi on this side, and it stands till this day. So yeah, I'm considered taurahere, or matawai, a different face from another place. And one of the, when I was asked to come on and be lead coordinator for Matariki, one of the first things I wanted to do was reach out to kohunui marae and papa, or at least, you know, let them know that this is what we're wanting to do. There isn't a traditional marae in Featherston. These are our marae, really. So if you think Featherston, back in 1855, and I reckon there's some geo-historians here, we had a big earthquake out there, 1855, raised the lake bed up some places 6 metres. So that's why it was never settled, eh, by hapu and iwi previously, because it was swampy. Featherston used to be a riverbed, used to be swamp. But it was known as a place of abundant kai. And I've been told by Ra Smith out there, he's a local legend, historian, educator, just amazing kaumata, that Featherston was known as a taupahi. Taupahi is a place of abundant kai. So it's a seasonal place of gathering kai. So since I've moved out there, I'm just like, I'm so in love with Featherston, I want to find out everything about it, right from Mairano, right from way back. I'm trying to find out the history of it, I'm going to go right back to 950 AD when Kupe came. And even before then, there's rumours of Ui Te Rangiora, who went down to Antarctica in 650 AD. So, you know, wanting to collect all of those morsels of our little town and put them together. I'm rambling, I'm going off. Come back, Waza. Come back, bro. I'm just sharing my love for our little town, you know. Yeah, so 1855, it was swamp, earthquake, raised it. Henry Burling came to town and thought, let's start a town here. And then not long after that, Dr. Isaac Featherston took over. I think he was a policeman, hence Featherston. Yeah, but with our Matariki conversation, really wanted to reach out to mana whenua and make sure that, you know, we have their support. And it's been really great. I was out at Papawai, that photo was taken last week when we had our Featherston Booktown. And we took Witi Humaira and Patricia Grace and a number of writers out to Papawai just to whanaungatanga, you know. And it was beautiful. They had these double rainbows and, you know, he tohu pai. And one of our Matariki events is we're having a noho marae out at Kohunui, Kohunui marae overnight stay. So yeah, when I got asked to lead this kaupapa, I also want to acknowledge the people who had been involved 2 years prior to this, because we've been having Matariki, well, celebrating Matariki 2 years beforehand. So yeah, 2020 I think was our first one. Might have even been 2019. And it was just a small celebration. You know, we had a little karakia down at the lake, and then a kai. And then the year after that, got a little bit bigger. We had some kids coming along and playing some bark on strings or something. And yeah, so this year is just growing. And we thought, because it's the first time that Matariki is a national holiday celebration, we'd put a bit more energy in it. So we put out a survey to our community to see what they'd be keen to experience, you know, or participate in. And we had a few events listed. And I just think it's really exciting to note that the event most in demand is the kaumātua pūrākau storytelling. You know, people want to hear our old people tell stories. And that became apparent from this survey that we put out. There was only 40 responses, I'm going to say, but, you know, we're a little town. That's big. That's big news in our town. But, yeah, you know, just to know that people want to hear our old people. People want to be connected with our old people telling those stories, yeah. So we put this survey out, and this informed us. This informed our festival. I was talking with Tanya earlier today, just, you know, the great thing about living in a small town is you get to know everyone. And through events like this, we realise we've got some amazing people living. I mean, everyone's amazing, you know. But we have amazing people, and when you put an event together, suddenly they came out of the woodwork, you know, and they just put their hand up to help. It was a really great example of that with Booktown last weekend. Just incredible. Everyone wanted to volunteer. Everyone wanted to help. And the same with this, you know, we've got people wanting to help, wanting to contribute. It's exciting that with New Zealand histories being taught in our schools, yay! With Matariki being celebrated, you know, yay! With Te Reo being supported, resourced, and there's a real groundswell of redress and reconnecting happening, and it's really very heartwarming. I'm just excited for our mokopuna about 2 or 3 generations from now, you know. They're all going to be fluent in Te Reo, in English. They're all going to know their whakapapa, wherever they come from. They're all going to celebrate Matariki, maybe a bit more understanding around rungoa. But mātauranga Māori is going to, well, I think we're going to see a real rise in mātauranga Māori. Remembering too, that navigating by the stars and all of this old knowledge. I think it was my friend Ben Lemmy who coined the term AI as actual ancestral intelligence. Yeah, I love that. You know, they didn't get out a PDF to sail across the Pacifica, Moana, or Google Maps. That was some ancient knowledge. Yeah. And a lot of it we've lost, but a lot of it's coming back, thanks to you know, the likes of Dr. Rangi Mā, Tā Mua Mā. Yeah. So this is our festival. Oh, how do I can go back one, actually. That whakatauki down the bottom there, I think it's supposed to be Kā Mua, Kā Muri, but that's like walking backwards into the future. So you're always... Sorry, Mark. You're always acknowledging your past, but moving forward. I like the analogy that it's like when you're driving, you're looking in the rearview mirror and just always acknowledging the past. It informs our future. Yeah, so this is our schedule. We're going to open on the Thursday night there with our three schools. Our three schools are combining to give us a kapahaka performance. We'll open with karakia. Then on the Friday, we're inviting community members to go down to our local Featherston Cemetery. A big part of Matariki is remembering our loved ones who have passed on that year. So we've got 1,675 graves at Featherston, and all of the schools are going to make harakeke flowers, puti puti. They're going to make 1,675 flowers and put one on every single grave at Featherston Cemetery. Cool, eh? And then we've got our first pūrākau storytelling. Some of our pūrākau storytelling are for littlies, some of them are for us big kids. So we've got a nice variety in there. We've got a mini train, a mini fell train out there, and light exhibit. I get jealous of those, you know, those light exhibits that you see up in, what's that, Festival of Light up in Taranaki, and up in, down in Christchurch, they got a beautiful festival. So I think, hey, we're heading that way, eh, Tanya? But what I'd like to think is that we encourage our Featherston makers to make our own light exhibitions, and our tamariki to make their own light exhibitions. I just scored some phosphorus paint, so just to let you know. And then on the Saturday morning, we're putting down a hangi, 6 o'clock. And while that's in the ground cooking, we've got a matariki car boot sale, and then we have a community kai at the Anzac Hall, more storytelling. And then there's a noho marae starts at 3 o'clock out at Kohonui, where we get pōhirid on to the marae. In putting this together, you know, it makes me realise how many people have not been onto a marae. Hey. So that was a big incentive for organising this noho. It's just to give people an opportunity, whether you're Māori, from wherever, you know, anywhere, doesn't matter, just haramai. Experience karanga, experience whai kōrero, experience, and then sit with kaumātua out there and listen to their stories. Time seems to be pretty sparse these days, eh? We're filling up our days with mahi, and so it's going to be nice just to sit for an afternoon and a morning and kōrero. Just kōrero. Cup of tea, kōrero. Yeah. Then on the Sunday, we've got a dawn karakia out there. More storytelling. Sunday afternoon, the Wellington Chamber Orchestra is coming out to play at Anzac Hall. And one of the cool things about that is they're going to feature Thomas Nikora, who is from the Wairarapa. So he's a young rangatahi. He's probably in his 20s now, though. Sorry, Thomas. But amazing, virtuosic pianist. And we've got a beautiful Steinway piano out there at the Anzac Hall. So we're really privileged to have the Wellington Chamber Orchestra come out and perform as part of our Matariki Festival. Then straight after that, we've got a DJ vinyl club. Yeah? Talk about polarising, eh? And then we have our kai. On the Monday night, we have Te Atahia Hurihanga Nui coming down to give us a kōrero on Maramataka. And then we finish off the festival on Tuesday night with Under the Stars. Anyone know Under the Stars? They come out and basically give a kōrero with a laser pointer up telling us about the stars at night time. And then we have a karakia to close. So yeah, that's our festival. He tihe paunamu, however small, it's a treasure, you know. But I want to say it's been a lot of work, but it's worth it, especially for Featherston. And just lifting whakamana te ao Māori, you know. Yeah. These are our events. Mā nawatia matariki. I just wanted to mihi to Dr. Rangi Mā Tamu again. Haven't put your name up there, bro, sorry. My tūhoi, brother. So, I must admit, I get confused sometimes. I haven't completely embedded these, but We've got Matariki there, who's the mother of all these stars. We've got Nukuarangi, Tupuanuku. Pohutukawa down there at the bottom. Pohutukawa is the one who looks after our dead, our past, ones who have passed. Waiti, Waita, salt water and fresh water. Hiwa I te rangi, anyone know hiwa I te rangi? Yeah, the wishes, eh? Yeah, that's our wishing star. And then up the top we've got Waipuna Rangi, which is all about the rain, and Ura Rangi, which is about wind. Yeah. So that's me whānau. I just, you know, thank you again for the invitation to kōrero. Hope you're not all asleep out there. I can't really see that far out the back there, but yeah, ka nui te mihi ki a koutou. I think we're going to have a bit of a kōrero session or something. Yeah. Go easy on me. Yeah. But no, thank you, whānau. Yeah, we have a kōrero. Your choice.
Ngā mihi nui ki a koe e Warren.
Kia ora tānia.
Beautiful kōrero and images as well. So thank you for that. And I would like to know, because 2022 is a historic moment, Matariki being celebrated for the first time as a national holiday, what you think that means for Aotearoa, New Zealand as a nation?
Yeah. The first word that comes to mind is puawai. So puawai is, you know, when the flower opens and blossoms. Puawai, so it's sort of like, it feels like the whole nation's just opening up. And, you know, starting to accept, you know, mātauranga Māori as part of all of us. It's you know, we're a whāriki, eh? We're a woven mat, you know. We got whakapapa from Scotland and England, from all over the world. And, yeah, for me, it's an amazing time, I feel like, as a nation, we've just gone, and starting to embrace how special mātauranga Māori is, yeah? Especially with our kids, eh? You know, you see our kids in school, and there's a lot of learning in schools. A lot of work to be done, but a lot of learning in schools now. It's become just omnipresent, you know? Everyone's saying kia ora, and so it's like taking that and just growing it, you know, little one word at a time. Kia ora e hoa. Kei te pehea. 7 o'clock.
And it will be a great moment for everyone who just goes to one event, maybe, to celebrate Matariki and does something different to educate themselves what it's all about. So looking forward to that.
Yeah.
Now, Featherston Matariki is different from council-planned events in that it's community-led. Mm. And we saw the survey, so it really started with what does the community want and kind of co-designing the events, right, Warren?
Yeah.
Tell us a bit about how the community came along.
Well, one of the great things about Featherston is, yeah, like I mentioned before, everyone knows everyone, pretty much. Or it's that one degree of separation. So, you know, it feels like as soon as someone even thinks of an idea, it's already out on the Featherston Facebook page and getting lots of rhetoric and lots of, you know, lots of contribution, I should say. So, I mean, this festival had been going previously for the last 2 years, I'm pretty sure. But I think, you know, as things grow, whether it's a festival or an idea or some kind of community initiative, I think when people see the joy and the value of others, that others are having, they're like, oh, I want to get in on that, you know. I want a piece of that. That's what I've sort of felt, you know. It started really small a couple of years ago, literally just with a karakia down at the lake in a kai. And now we've got all this sort of 3 years later. I would hope that it wouldn't get much bigger than this. You know, we're not about corporate sponsorship and all that kind of stuff. One of the comments actually on our survey was keep it small and keep it Featherston, you know, centric, and bring people to Featherston. So, yeah, I think just community, there's just a magnetism, there's an attraction to things like this. Yeah.
It might be interesting for people to hear how many others were involved in the committee and like the funding you have.
Yeah, great call, yeah. So we've got Featherston businesses involved. We've got, you know, local hospitality, local cafes and restaurants. We've got all three schools. All three schools have come on board. You know, then you get individuals, you know, like Tanya comes along. As I hadn't met you before this, had I?
At a cafe in Kōrero once.
Oh, that's right, yeah. That's right, yeah. So, yeah, and then we've got councillors involved. Like, we've had funding from, you know, council have been really supportive of this. I think it's also, I've got to say, because South Wairarapa District Council have realised that they're legislated to support cultural events and cultural awareness. They have to do this as part of their mandate, you know. So it's been great having them ka whakapu awai as well as a council. It's like, oh. But then I also think, you know, they've got their work cut out themselves, you know, with three waters and all of these climate change and all of these other things going on. So I feel like they are really grateful that our community has taken this on and we haven't put all the onus on them to say, hey, you guys need to get us a, you know, thing. So it's been a really good partnership, yeah. And we're really supporting local businesses. I mean, who's been out to Featherston? Who's been out to Featherston? Yeah, Kapoi. So it's a small town, eh? Not many businesses out there, so it's nice to support local, yeah.
And has there been any negative response from the community at all?
I'm waiting till after the festival for that. No. I'm sure there's been something, but I just sort of Apple delete. Nothing really substantial. No. It was no.
That's good.
No. It's all been really positive. There has been a bit of flack. So we've got a funding body out there called FabFeathy, and this is all part of DIA. So we've got a partnership with DIA, and we apply for funding through FabFeathy. And there was a little bit of negative pushback around the name Feathy. I think some people are really proud of Featherston and probably that history that goes with it. And, you know, when you sort of truncate or, you know, slang something up like Feathy, you're going to get a bit of pushback, but oh, you can't please everybody. Oh boy.
So we have a few questions online, and just a reminder, if you do have a question on the Zoom, please put it in the Q&A. So someone asks, why do you think it's taken so long for Matariki to be recognised?
Wow, such a great question. I don't know. I think we all, you know, get a feeling for how long, especially when you're talking about central government policy, legislation, blah, 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 how long things take to... The Titanic's not probably the right metaphor or analogy to use, but it just takes a long time to turn this waka. And so if I think back to my schooling, 1970s, you know, there might have been a token waiata that you learn just as a hobby type of thing. And to think that it's taken 50 years and more, like we've had some kaumātua, some, you know, real legends fighting for Māttauranga Māori and Te Reo Māori. I think Te Reo has been the focus, you know, with the Tauriwhiri Language Commission. You know, when we, I think that established back in 1975. So I think there's been a lot of focus on Te Reo. And then when you push Te Reo out to the front, then everything else follows behind it, you know. I've fallen madly in love with Te Reo. I just love the poetry of Te Reo. You know, I'm obsessed with Te Reo. you know, our ancestors just spoke in metaphors and poetry all the time. And it's just lovely. So yeah, I guess Matariki and, you know, navigating by the stars and rongoā and, you know, rāranga and all of these things are just are following in behind. It's like the wake out the back of a waka. You know, the waka has been te reo and all of these other things are falling into place behind. I'm thinking, I'm no anthropologist or anything like that. I'm just making it all up, to be honest. But these are just my thoughts, why it's taken so long for Matariki. And also, I've got to say, for somebody like Rangi Mā Tāmua, who has, you know, been given all of this knowledge from, I think, one of his uncles or his great-uncle, who my mum knew back in school, you know, it took that time. It's happened at the right time for the right reasons with the right people. And that's just the universe at work, I suppose. Yeah.
And with public holidays, there's always the danger, I guess, or the risk that it becomes commercialised, and I've already seen the first Matariki chocolate. So how do you feel about it?
Yeah, I'm really on the fence about that one, eh? I mean, yeah, you know, I really support, you know, business and entrepreneurship, absolutely. But I think there is a line. There is a line. The big thing for me, and it goes back to Kohonui and Papawai, is you've got to ask, you know, you've got to ask people for, you know, if you're using a certain design of, you know, for a chocolate, you know, you got to make sure that that's not some ancestor's moko you're using and things like that, you know, and just even be cognizant and aware of those kinds of things. Yeah. I mean, it's a reality, you know, business is business. We all got bills to pay. Something I'm really an advocate of is he aha te kaupapa. What's the kaupapa behind it, you know? If it's purely just to make a whole heap of money, you know, there, if there was maybe a bit of a sort of some kind of feedback into the community off the back of, you know, your profiting, something like that, circular economy, green economy, goes back into some profits, go back to schools or something, eh, to our tamariki or something, then yeah.
And I'm going to open up for questions from the floor soon. But one little story I wanted to relay about the community input in Featherston and how people are wanting to be really helpful is that on our Facebook page, we said for the hangi, we're looking for someone with a digger. Who has a digger to dig the hangi pit? And Warren can finish off.
Yeah, so we're very contemporary. I'd love to say we all get out there 4 o'clock in the morning with shovels and spades, but okay, so Featherston is a riverbed, and we have rocks the size of Kansas on, you know, underneath. And I swear, I've planted so many trees out there, and every single hole is with a big bar, you know, that you've got to dig with. So yeah, so we put the you know, the pānui out, put the pātai out. Anyone got a digger? We've got a digger now. But then it just kept going, you know. Oh, has anyone got stones, hangi stones? And yep, we've got hangi stones. Has anyone got crates? Yep, we've got crates. You know, it just keeps coming and coming and coming. And, yeah, so that's just the great thing about that community out there. Like many other communities, I don't think we're the only community with this kind of thing going on, but it feels special. Featherston's had a rough time, I want to say, in the 80s, and like a lot of small towns, you know, industries shut down. But it's really on the rise, you know. It's a cool little town, yeah. So please stop in, you know, when you come, have a coffee. Or got a great cheese shop and really cool restaurants out there.
And next we'll put out a pānui for peeling the potatoes.
Oh, yeah.
So it's great to see communities coming together for Matariki, because I think that's what it was all about, really, was...
Yeah.
gathering your harvest and celebrating together and sharing stories and huddling around a fire and all that. So I think that's a great tribute to exactly that. So are there any questions in the audience?
Kia ora.
Kia ora.
Kia ora.
Thank you, Warren, and the organisation for organising and accommodating us and giving us an insight into these, this interesting array of events, and particularly your role, which is clear to me in this, is some of us from years gone by, others of Featherstonites. Along with your friends and local people was wonderful.
Kia ora.
And so I wish you in your committee meeting all the best for your events.
Thank you, Ray.
I've got your calendar here.
No mahara mai. Have a look for that little cottage used to live in there.
Yeah, that's in there. Warren's talking about my mother's little old cottage. It doesn't belong to our family anymore.
Yeah. Oh yeah, might be a big line. Oh, tēnā koe te rangatira. Yeah, nei rā te mihi ki a koe. Kia ora, bro.
Tēnā kōrua, ngā mihi nui mō tēnei kōrero, hei pātai iti. I'm a keen language learner, and I also came late. Did you explain... on your poster, I think it says Paetūmokai.
Oh, yes.
The only meaning I know for mokai is slave, and it's always been a very controversial word. And I miss an explanation as to the words on the poster, or could you?
Oh, he pātai tino reka tērā, kia ora. So, no, I hadn't actually talked about Paetūmokai. So, again, when I moved out there... it wasn't a name that was really well known, and possibly for that very reason that mokai is one term for slave, but it can also be an endearing term for like a pet. So mokai, the term mokai is pet, yeah. And I've researched, I've asked, I've gone to kaumātua from Puna no te Wairarapa, and there are a few different stories where that came from. So one story is that a chief out there used to have a bird, a pet bird, and the bird went missing one day and was found caught in a pai. So P-A-E is a snare, is one name for a snare. It's also the name for a horizontal surface, like a pai, you know, the pai on your marae, or a branch, a horizontal branch. But yeah, so that's one kōrero that was... Paetūmokai was a chief who lost his pet bird, and it was found in a snare. Another one from one of the kaumātua out there was Paetūmokai o Tauira. So Tauira, one kōrero was that Tauira was the name of one of Kupe's dogs. So when Kupe came down to Palisa, down to Wairarapa, went walking up around our area and asked his dog to sit and look after the place. So Paetūmokai or Tauira, so the sitting place of Tauira was his name. Another kōrero was around the sister of Te Rerewa, and her name was Hine Tauira. And there's one kōrero that there was possibly a whare wānanga for wahine out there, but Hine Tauira was the mother of Te Rangi Tāwhanga, who... came down to Wairarapa. Kahanunu came down, and Te Rerewa was living out at Lake Ferry, Onoki. And Te Rangi Tāwhanga asked his uncle if he could use land. And then, so Te Rangi Tāwhanga did that, built four waka, and Te Rerewa then took his hapu over to Blenheim. So that's the connection there between Wairarapa and Rangitāne down in Blenheim. Yeah. So, yeah, there's lots of kōrero around that, and I love that, you know. It's not the idea of looking for the one true explanation. It's like they're all right. All of these stories, they came from somewhere, yeah. But the full name of Featherston, the old name of Featherston, is Paetūmokai o Tauira, yeah. Yeah. Kia ora for that pātai, yeah, I'd forgotten that kōrero. Naughty me. Yeah, thank you.
Do we have any more questions?
Do we need to get back to our office, back to work, back to mahi? Yeah, we love our mahi though, eh? Hey.
So it's just to thank Warren that for his amazing kōrero, and I've experienced your hospitality, manaakitanga, and being inclusive on the Paetūmokai Matariki committee. So Warren is someone who brings people along on the journey, and I'm really thankful for that. And I hope that whatever you do on Matariki, that you enjoy yourself, that you open the pathway for Māttauranga Māori, and just have a really amazing time, and maybe you come to Paetūmokai. So we'd love to finish off with a waiata. It's called He Waiata Matariki, and some of you might know it. Warren will grab his guitar, and we have the words up as well. So another community engagement.
Now, I've just learned this morning, so you might have to remind me how it goes, actually. We've got those kupu up there. Ooh, I've already forgotten how. What's the first of that? Oh, yeah, cool. Matariki, matariki, e arae. Sorry.